We move to a double feature by Ben Kaiser and Mark Hollands on the detection of lithium accreted by white dwarfs.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ben Kaiser. I'm a PhD student at the University of North Carolina. My advisor is Chris Clemens. The rest of our collaboration is listed below my name there. I will be giving a split talk with Mark Hollands, where I will open with a few slides, then I'll hand off to Mark and swap out screen share. He'll do his slides, and then we'll switch back to screen share, and I'll close out the session with a few more slides, just to keep it complicated. Mark, would you like to introduce yourself right now? So, kind of coming in.
If he's able to. Hello. I'm Mark. I'm a postdoc at Warwick working with Pierre Emmanuel. So just say hi, but I guess I'll just let you get on with the rest of the talk.
Okay. Yeah. We will be discussing the detection of lithium in cool white dwarf atmospheres and our respective discoveries thereof. Lithium had never before been identified in a white dwarf atmosphere before our papers. Right. My collaborators and I first identified lithium in white dwarf J1644-0449, which is a low-temperature helium-dominated white dwarf that we discovered in Gaia DR2 as part of our ongoing survey of objects beyond the red terminus of the white dwarf sequence. We also identified potassium, which was yet another element not before identified in a white dwarf. All the metals that I'll be discussing in this talk, and that Mark will be as well, are created from planetary material as discussed in preceding talks of the day. J1644 is also not in any of the published Gaia DR2 white dwarf catalogs, like due to its colors. And I'm not sure if it's in Nicola's new EDR3 catalog, because I haven't really seen what's in there exactly, but we'll find out later, I guess. We observed J1644 using the atmospheric, using the Goodman spectrograph on the SOAR telescope. And then our collaborators, Simone Bluin and Patrick Dufour, did the atmospheric modeling to get the parameters, like, and the abundances as well. We also identified and measured lithium in a second white dwarf, SDSS J1330 plus 6435, using its archival SDSS spectrum. It's a white dwarf with a very similar sodium D absorption feature, which is why we checked it for lithium in the first place. Mark will be sharing his own exciting discoveries of these elements in J1330 and some other white dwarfs in his portion of the talk coming up. It turns out the detection of potassium, sodium, and calcium together provides an excellent opportunity for identifying the kind of accreted body without having to worry as much about accretion phase, due in part to the similar diffusion timescales of potassium and calcium, resulting from their similar masses. Potassium and sodium also have very similar condensation temperatures and chemical properties, given they're both alkalis, while calcium has a much higher condensation temperature than those two, like 500 Kelvin higher or so. This relationship of these three elements gives rise to the strongly correlated solar system body distribution you see in this figure. The upper end of the sequence corresponds to lower formation temperatures, generally speaking, where the relatively volatile potassium and sodium are retained, while further down the sequence, potassium and sodium would be lost. Potassium and sodium are very difficult to separate by temperature alone. We can see for J1644, these abundances place it in the vicinity of primitive meteorites, irrespective of accretion phase. In a later figure of this talk, I will be showing this with more labels for solar system bodies to show you what the other areas of this figure correspond to. But for now, I'm leaving them off because this is the one directly from our paper, and they would have made us explain what every single symbol meant, and that would have taken too much space. Sorry, one more point on this slide that I forgot to mention. We did not use lithium in our analysis of the kind of accreted body, though, for a very important reason. Lithium has a different galactic abundance history than all of these other metals because lithium was made in the Big Bang, while other metals such as calcium and iron had to be formed in stars or other processes over time. The implication of the Big Bang origin of lithium for, well, a lot of lithium, not all of lithium, but most of it, not most, a lot, sorry, is that the protostellar nebulae that are older than our own solar system are predicted to have had higher levels of lithium relative to iron and all the other metals, as shown in this plot. Since lithium started from the Big Bang nucleosynthetic value and iron and other metals had to be made in stars, lithium to iron started high and decreased as time passed to the present values for a new protostellar nebulae. We attempted to demonstrate this in our science paper using lithium to calcium, but we did not have the benefit of the Prantsos enrichment curve at the time. So we tried to show this using main sequence stars with our white dwarfs. One can see that for our lithium-bearing white dwarfs, which are also 8 to 9 giga years old or so, There are some main sequence stars that reach up near them, but the white dwarfs are still above their contemporaries. This is not a coincidence, nor is it evidence of incorrect lithium abundances in our measurements. In fact, this overabundance relative to main sequence stars of similar age is precisely what one should expect to occur in extrasolar planetesimals, because it is what we see in our own solar system. I would direct your attention to the point that represents the lithium to calcium ratio measured directly from the sun, which is the lower of these two highlighted points. The sun is known to burn lithium, which is why the CI chondrite abundance of lithium is the literature accepted value for the solar nebula's lithium abundance. This means CI chondrite analog extrasolar planetesimals are the keepers of the galactic lithium history, and their accretion by white dwarfs like J1644 and J1330 is the key to unlocking that history. And with that, I will hand over the reins to Mark to discuss his own exciting discoveries.
Okay, I think I need to, yep.
Yep, there we go, sorry.
Okay, so you should see my screen and my mouse. Yeah, so Ben's already told you about his white dwarfs, so I'm gonna tell you about the ones we found now, which we had published in Nature Astronomy last month, though we had some different conclusions on the answer. So we found our white dwarfs actually working on our 40 parsec Gaia sample of trying to find all white dwarfs, where the first results of this for the Northern Hemisphere have been published last year by Tremblay and McCleary et al. And overall, we found four white dwarfs, four with lithium and one with potassium as well. And Ben has already mentioned the object that we have in common, SCSJ 1330. And these white dwarfs indeed are, again, all very cool objects. And so putting them in the Gaia HR diagram, we can see them all here at the very red end of the diagram. And you also see that one of them is actually quite offset in terms of its luminosity, suggesting it's very massive. And so I'm going to walk you through those spectra now, starting with LHS 2534. And some of you may already know this object because it was the first white dwarf discovered with both magnetism and metals at the same time. And you've got a few different elements, iron, calcium, chromium, sodium. But until now, we hadn't detected before lithium and potassium that we find here. But with a lovely X-shooter spectrum, we can tease out the lithium-Zeeman triplet, as well as seeing the Zeeman splitting pattern from potassium. Next up is WJ2317. This is the very massive white dwarf I mentioned before. And it has only three elements that we can see, calcium, sodium, and lithium. But actually here we have a mixed hydrogen helium atmosphere as the background and roughly a 1-to-1 ratio. Third up is WDJ1824, which again, actually like the last object, has this mixed atmosphere composition and those same three elements again. And then finally, SDSJ 1330 plus 6435. So this wasn't actually part of the Gaia sample that we looked at, but again, we found it from looking at archival SDSS spectra, and this has a helium-dominated atmosphere, which is what gives you the much broader sodium lines and calcium lines. But to actually learn anything about the planetary systems that these stars have, we actually have to model the spectra, and so we did that using the COESTA model atmospheres, and this turns out to be incredibly challenging because these stars are so cool. At the photosphere, we're looking at extremely high densities approaching sort of 1 gram per cm cubed. So you're very much in the regime of warm, dense matter. And so that's the sort of place where equation of states and et cetera can be quite unconstrained. And so we're really pushing the limits of what white dwarf model atmospheres can do. You also need to include molecular opacities in fitting these stars, because at these temperatures you can form H2 molecules, and these can impact other species producing collision-induced absorption features, with the most important for us being H2 and HE. There's a few quirks, a couple of quirks that we had in the results from our fits, in particular finding that some of the white dwarf masses come out too small, which has been a problem found before for people fitting ultra-cool white dwarfs. But also we find the lithium lines weirdly narrow compared to what we expect. And so I'll show you that first. But here I have the lithium features for all four stars. And I think this panel demonstrates it best. But the orange curve shows the expected line profile shape. And you can see, yeah, it has a core in the line, but it also has very broad wings that just aren't seen in the data at all. And so we tried to remedy this by tuning the neutral broadening constant for this transition to better fit the data empirically. And we find that, of course, we get something that looks good in this panel and perhaps this one as well, which also has these two both having mixed atmospheres. But for the helium-dominated atmospheres, we still do fairly poorly. So there's still something odd about this line that we're not quite capturing. And so there's some work to be done in this regard. But actually looking at the fits overall, at least superficially, we do quite well. So you can see in the spectra, in the top panels, in general, we're able to fit the features quite nicely, particularly the sodium lines in all of the different atmospheric compositions. And looking at the photometry, going all the way from the U band through to the WISE bands, in pretty much all cases, we're able to do quite well, with perhaps the exception of this object where we had a bit more trouble with the infrared fluxes, but I'll talk about that more in a moment. But you'll notice these two stars with the mixed atmospheres, and we have these very strong CIA absorption features, collision-induced absorption. And despite that, especially in this object, we're able to fit all of the photometry very nicely. But like I say, that is rather superficial because when we look at the masses, well, for the first star, we see something largely sensible, 0.55 solar masses. And the second star, one solar mass, but that's what kind of what we were expecting given where it is in the HR diagram. And I should also mention that this means that it's the descendant of a B-type star. So we're looking at planet formation around B stars, which is quite cool. But for these two objects, which we find to be in the sort of ultra cool white dwarf regime, below 4,000 Kelvin, the masses turn out to be incredibly small. And that this is rather unrealistic given the age of the Milky Way should not have been able to produce white dwarfs with these masses yet. So there are some ingredients clearly missing from our model atmospheres, whether that be something to do with the equation of states or other opacities that may need to be included to better fit these spectra and get more reliable masses. And so I'm going to go back to this object that I mentioned about the infrared photometry. So we could fit the optical photometry fairly well, but to get a nice fit to the infrared photometry as well, I tried adding a debris disk component, so the white dwarf illuminating a disk which re-radiates in the infrared. And this produces something that looks actually quite reasonable, but given that we suspect there could be issues with our models, perhaps that's actually not a realistic hypothesis. But actually, if we just consider the photometry by itself, so no models involved, we have here on the right the WISE W1-2 color and the Gaia BP-RP color. And you can see that for BP-RP colors similar to this star, the WISE color is very different by about 4 sigma. So it does appear to be a real property of this object. But the real nail in the coffin that convinced us there was a disk here is calculating its convection zone properties. Given this is about one solar mass, its outer convection zone is very small, about 3 orders of magnitude smaller than for the other 3 white dwarfs. And as a result, its diffusion rates, the sinking time scales for material out of the convection zone, very short, only a few thousand years, compared with the millions of years for the other 3 stars in our work. And to observe the lines in the atmosphere of this white dwarf, given these short diffusion timescales, is basically a prerequisite for this star being in the process of accreting right now, which necessarily requires that there be a disk to accrete from. And so this leads us to conclude we found the oldest disk that anyone has found before at nearly 10 giga-year old cooling age. And because it's in a state of accretion, we can also calculate the accretion rates. And we find actually for lithium, we're talking less than 1 kilogram per second, so a really small rate. And if we assume a crust composition, overall, we find a 3 tons per second over the whole star. And speaking of crust, that brings me on to the final thing I want to talk about, which is abundances. So here we have our 4 white dwarfs in a plot of calcium to sodium ratio versus the lithium to sodium ratio, compared with a few different types of solar system objects, the Earth's continental crust, chondrites, the sun, and the bulk Earth. And these spokes emanating from the objects, these represent looking at the abundances in the past, accounting for the different diffusion rates of elements out of the atmosphere. So 2 million years ago, LHS 2534 looks like crust, but maybe 4 million years ago, it looks more sensible, like something like chondrites. And these objects, if you go back far enough, maybe they look like the Bulk Earth. But with this object, we have an extra constraint. We have potassium, which allows us to break this degeneracy. And so in this panel, looking at the calcium to sodium ratio, we see again, 2 million years ago, we have something that very much looks like crust, but it can never have at any point in its history have looked like these types of objects. And so we concluded the star has accreted some crust, and then we suggested that maybe that was the case for the other objects as well. And so the only thing I guess left to do is to start comparing them with Ben's results. And so we're looking again at these plots and Ben's plot that you saw before. And if we superimpose Ben's point for J1644 on our plot in terms of lithium, it looks very much in the same clustering, but in terms of potassium, there is far less. So this is where I'm going to hand you back to Ben, who's going to give you a more detailed comparison.
Thanks, Mark. First, where did it go? There it is. Sorry, I try to hide the meeting controls, and for some reason it pops in and out of existence. All right. Yep, Ben Kaiser here again. Time for part three, exciting conclusion. So as Mark just showed you a second ago, we can start comparing our objects on the same plot. So this is the same one as from my paper, except I've now added Mark's abundances for J2017 and LHS 2534. The J1330 values are still the ones from my paper, and that'll be the case for the rest of the talk. This one also includes the labels for all the solar system objects, which I realize can be kind of overwhelming, but it lets you at least look at the ones in the vicinity of whatever you're interested in at the time. And notably as well, I don't plot J1824 on this one because we don't have a potassium limit for it. Like neither I nor Mark have it. So it can't be plotted on this one. And so I show that by kind of whiting out that one on the legend. That's what I'm gonna do with the white dwarfs in all the future plots as well if they're not on the plot. So don't keep looking for them if it's whited out in the legend. But in this space, we can see LHS 2534 does fall near Earth continental crust and not near the primitive bodies like J1644 does. However, there are other elemental abundances that have been used in previous papers to determine if an accreted planetesimal was primitive or part of a differentiated body. Numerous papers have used the relative abundances of calcium, iron, and magnesium to identify if an accreted planetesimal is primitive or a differentiated piece of another body. And so we explore this parameter space for the only white dwarf with a lithium detection that also has abundances for these three elements, which is LHS 2534. We can see that the crust, mantle, and primitive material separate nicely in this parameter space, and LHS 2534 is located down with the collection of primitive bodies, where primitive means not being a piece of a differentiated body. It is also quite far from continental crust in this space, around 1 dex, which suggests its lithium overabundance is not the result of crust differentiation. It would then follow that these primitive rocky extrasolar planetesimals should be roughly representative of their protoplanetary nebular lithium abundances, as they are analogous to CI chondrites, as previously outlined by my collaborations paper. So we plot them here with CI chondrites and Prancis 2012's predicted lithium to iron versus age enrichment curve. J2317's age is just from Mark's paper. And then I calculated an age for LHS 2534 using the same method from my paper because there wasn't already an age calculated for it. We can see that the lithium to iron abundances of our accreted extrasolar planetesimals increase at greater ages, as one would expect, except there does appear to be an age mismatch, which could be because Prancis assumed a 12 giga-year-old disk. Why is that not going? There we go. If we instead assume a 10 giga-year-old disk, we get something like the blue dashed curve, which appears quite consistent with the white dwarfs. I just made this by contracting the time between the start and solar system, because that's the point that it has to pass through. So this is not a true new nuclear synthetic modeling, it's an approximation for right now. But yeah, given the agreement, generally speaking, of the white dwarf implied extrasolar planetesimal abundances and hypothetical shorter time for the evolution, it appears that galactic nucleosynthetic evolution, as recorded by extrasolar planetesimals, causes a lithium overabundance in the oldest white dwarfs, in our view, meaning my collaborations. I'll speak to Mark. Yeah. Thank you for your time and this opportunity to speak.
Thanks, Ben. Thanks, Mark. That was really exciting. Do we have questions? Yes.
Hi, Ben and Mark. Thanks for your talks. Before your papers came out, planetary modelers effectively never had to worry about crystallization because all of the polluted white dwarfs were young enough so that it was never a factor. And so I'm wondering if, especially if more of these polluted white dwarfs that are older than 9 or have cooling ages that are over 9 billion years are found, what considerations do we need to reconsider now? I mean, will crystallization change the radius or the luminosity or the accretion rates in a way that we would have to incorporate?
Sorry, to clarify, when you're referring to crystallization, you're referring to white dwarf crystallization?
Yeah, or, that's right. Okay.
Accretion phases, I don't think that one would matter. Mark, you can obviously chime in here, but I think it would change maybe some of those other factors related to ages and luminosities, but accretion rate was just dependent on the convection zone calculations, which I don't think are dictated by.
No, they should be fine. That's calculated from the atmospheric parameters integrating downwards, essentially. So it shouldn't be influenced by what's happening in the core.
Luminosity and radius change, a significant one, that could change the sublimation radius and the Roche radius. And that's probably why I'm asking as well.
So our inferences, though, don't technically depend on the Roche radius and sublimation radius in terms of the material in the photosphere itself. How it gets there, yeah, I guess. But Mark, do you have anything to
add? I think you covered that.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Because unlike Mansur, we're not doing anything with like disk abundances. We're just measuring inside the photosphere.
Okay, Tim?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks both for an interesting talk. I had a question from Mark about your oldest white dwarf with a disk. Well done for finding the oldest.
Thanks.
It might be a silly question, but the SED that you showed, where you have the white dwarf component and the component from the disk, it seemed like the white dwarf component already had an excess in infrared. I don't know if I missed the explanation for what causes that. I don't know if you know.
Sorry, no. We could fit the optical photometry quite nicely, and then there was, if you just fitted the optical photometry by itself, you would get something where the model flux sat quite below the infrared photometry. So to be able to match the infrared photometry as well, you need to add some extra flux.
But there was a bump in the infrared in the white dwarf model. Is that
a downwards bump? That was
no, an upwards bump. Well, maybe it was a downwards bump. I don't know. It was a downwards bump.
There's the collision-induced absorption from molecular hydrogen, and then the flux recovers a little bit. So that was why we were a little suspicious at first and a bit wary at first before claiming that we'd found a disk, but then we found the other pieces of evidence that we needed.
Cool, thanks. Yeah, I missed that as a upwards bump. Thanks.
Wolfgang.
Hey, I have a quick, probably boring methods question. So when you fit this, did you fit photometry and spectroscopy at once, and what likelihood did you use?
I can't speak for Ben's paper, so in our case, we essentially used the photometry for plus the Gaia parallax for constraining the temperature and the radius, and then we use the spectra basically just to constrain the metals, which is especially important, well, in these objects with fairly featureless spectra apart from just the few metal lines. And then the hydrogen abundance as well, you can actually kind of constrain it in both cases because you get the hydrogen to helium ratio is constrained by not just the opacity features in the infrared, but also the width of the metal lines. So you can use all that information to get something that gives you a self-consistent result across the spectra and the photometry.
Yeah. So how did you propagate that? Sorry, how did you propagate the uncertainties then from one fit to the other fit? Do you then try different ones for the other one, or what did you do?
In our work, we didn't look at that in so much detail. We assumed that at least the metal abundances in the stars we were looking at were not having a great effect on the photometric things, so the temperature and the radius, essentially, were what we were measuring. And certainly that would probably have an increased effect on the abundance uncertainties, but we didn't look into that for our work. But that's something we could do. It would make maybe a 0.05 dex difference.
So yeah, ours was a little different. I think Simone's here, so if I do an injustice to anything you did, Simone, feel free to tell people. He handled all the modeling with Patrick Dufour, Simone Bluing. But essentially, my understanding, he did an iterative process, so we used the parallax and photometry like Mark did as well. But so once he got the first solution from that, he then used spectroscopy to get abundances of metals and then took those back into his photometry, because in the white dwarfs we were dealing with, especially that huge sodium line and then absorption on the blue side from other metals does have an effect on photometry, so he would recalculate the photometry and parallax related stuff using those new metal inputs and keep iterating that till it converged. I don't know how many times you had to do that. And then used IR and that same kind of stuff to get the hydrogen content limit, in addition to the line widths. But given how broad the sodium was, it pretty much guaranteed it was mostly helium dominated. Yeah, that's related to why the hydrogen content's not well constrained for 1330. There's not a ton of IR photometry. Although Mark found another point that would be useful. But
thanks, Mark and Benjamin.
Roberto?
Hi, I have a question for Mark. Maybe he already addressed that and I missed it, but when he showed the spectrum for this SDSS 1330,
yes,
like there are two absorptions for lithium. It's just because the spectrum is noisy?
Yeah, it's just noisy. So in principle, lithium is a doublet, but the actual distance in angstrom between the two components is like a fraction of an angstrom. It's not even a pixel in SDSS, so yeah. It's not to do with that. I mean, it's a noisy spectrum, so I think that is just the explanation.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I have a question mainly to Ben, but also to Mark, and that is, would you now, given where we are, predict that all debris accreting white dwarfs that are old enough should have lithium?
Hans? Not entirely, because for one, I think Mark is right that geology is a factor in the lithium abundances. I don't think it's the reason for the excess we're seeing, but you can deplete lithium from geological effects, where I say geological, like in terms of any planetary process, because obviously asteroids aren't Earth or other planets aren't Earth. But, so like, for example, there's one in our paper that was like a limit that wasn't rich in lithium, but it was still old, but that's possibly because it was depleted in lithium due to cometary processes. So trying to figure that one out. But yeah, we would not expect to see this lithium enhancement in young objects, but you can't detect it anyway because they're too hot.
Okay.
But yeah, generally speaking, I would say you would expect them to be higher, older you go.
Okay, thanks. JJ?
I just have a quick question for maybe the theorists on the call, which is that if we believe Mark and that this lithium, and at least one of these white dwarfs, is coming from sort of like the shredded crust of a planet, that means there was a giant impact that liberated that crust. Can that tell us anything about whether or not that rock actually came from the white dwarf that it is now accreting on, or do the dynamics make it more favorable for that ripped off piece of crust to have come from another star system? Because I would assume that these collisions would have to happen out far enough from the star that these big pieces have survived stellar evolution. And so if this story is right, does it say anything about the fact that maybe this came from another star system? I'll just throw that out there.
Well, I'd say there's no reason that the collisions that you sort of speak about couldn't happen post main sequence anyway. And I think theorists, I know Dimitri's on the call, but would argue that the rate of collisions between objects are increased post main sequence. I don't know if Dimitri would like to say anything or anyone else.
I think giant impacts, well, at least based on our simulations, are quite rare, but smaller impacts certainly are more frequent. So by that, I mean, you can have like cratering type of impacts. If you have like a late heavy bombardment, except during the white dwarf phase. So that's certainly more common because as Ava showed us earlier, you can get instabilities that are triggered by giant branch mass loss. And then those instabilities can effectively re-trigger the dynamics of the system. And so that's one way of removing the crust perhaps from a planet.
I should say as well, actually, the amount of mass we're looking at is not it's not as big as some of the numbers we see in other white dwarfs. The biggest we concluded here was sort of 10 to the 20 grams. So it's where people see up to 10 to the 24 grams in other white dwarfs. So we're looking at fairly small splinters of crust potentially.
Okay. Dimitri, did you have another question or no? Okay.
No.
I think then that's a good time to close the session and like thank again our four speakers for great talks. And just as a quick reminder, that we've got two more sessions tomorrow, one on white dwarfs and binaries and one on transients, burning, shell burning, and kind of supernovae. Starting at the same time as today, so 8 a.m. And that's it for today. Feel free to keep chatting on Slack and have a great day and great evening wherever you are. And see you all tomorrow. Bye-bye.